Hello and welcome to another episode of Historic Hindsight. I'm John, that's Tom, and today we're talking about JFK.
Well,
was it Martin Luther King?
No, it's about a presidential assassination attempt, but it's a little bit more recent than that, Johnny. We're doing some recent history, historic hindsight, I don't know if you remember or not, Johnny, but somebody attempted to murder a senator, a judge, and President Obama with some ricin letters back in 2013. Yeah, it was on the news. I briefly remember this, and it was like only a footnote until you hear the whole story of what happened. Like, the assassination attempt isn't the fun part about the story. That's not why we're doing it. It's who tried it, why they tried it, and like the feud that led up to it.
Okay, but so was this was during a time, this was when like a bunch of letters were, there was a time where like
that was post 9/11
letters with poison were being sent.
So post 9/11 there was a
it was
time
just like a thing people were doing.
Yeah, they were sending anthrax letters, which actually did kill people. These ricin letters aren't even gonna hurt anybody, but it was sent. So it harkened back to that. There was this big media
they
frenzy.
They tried,
like,
though.
Yeah, they tried. There's this big media frenzy, like, oh my god, it's a terrorist attack and they're at it again, and this like but it's not. So, let's get into it, Johnny.
All right, let's talk about
it. It's April 15th, 2013, and we're at the U.S. Capitol on the off-site mail facility when they intercept a letter that the FBI claims contains ricin, which, if you're not aware of what that is, it's a...
Now, how... Do they just have tests for that as letters come in? Are there detectors, and it's like, ding,
FYI, if you're going to mail a destructive device... Don't do it to places like
put it in an
Capitol
Amazon box
office or like the White House, because they check for this shit. It doesn't even get to the White House or the Capitol building. It gets to a mail center first, where it gets checked, and then sent to the next location.
I mean, what you have to do is you have to just have to put it in an Amazon box and pretend it's the president's new
TV.
You know,
or whatever.
I don't know.
I'm still sure that's going to get checked. I just have a feeling that that's going to get changed.
Maybe. We'll see. I don't know. He puts a lot of Amazon orders in.
God, could you imagine like an Amazon driver just driving up to the White House and just like throwing the package
up to the White House
like,
and
taking his little picture and driving?
Just chucking it over the fence because it can't get past it. They're like, I don't have time for this shit.
That's great. Anyways, if you're not sure what ricin is, ricin is a very toxic protein that was right around. It's not a coincidence that he used ricin, because it was right around that time that Breaking Bad did that whole same thing where they used ricin in an episode. But it's made out of castor beans, and those are this. If you're not sure what those are, you ever have the little counties when you're in math and when you're in elementary school and you had these beans that you counted? Yeah, those are the same beans that you can make ricin with. And they're also the same beans that like you cut in half in science and like made them grow and shit. Yeah, it's the same. Yeah, we use those beans for everything. But you can also create...
All right, so they're
versatile. You can also create a really bad poison with that.
Also, you could kill people, potentially, or try to.
In any case, the U.S. Capitol's off-site mail facility, they intercept this, they see that it's got ricin, and it was intended for a Republican senator by the name of Roger Wicker. And the letter said, and I quote here, "No one wanted to listen to me before. There are still missing pieces. Maybe I have your attention now. If that means someone must die, this must stop. To see a wrong and not expose it is to become a silent partner to its continuance." None of that made any fucking sense, but sure, fine, whatever.
So this is just some delusional douchebag who thinks that he's like gonna be like the Zodiac killer or some bullshit like that.
Like, yeah, and it is most.
That's what he's doing. He's like living out some fantasy world he wants to be a part of.
Pretty much, and it's signed, Johnny. It's most important. It's signed. I am KC, and I approve this message. So if you are trying to do something like that, maybe come up with. I mean, don't put your initials on the letter.
But he approves the message, Tommy. He's not hiding behind it. If he is not going to out a wrong, whatever wrong.
Doesn't he say what wrong it is, by the way? There's no.
He has to make sure he outs whatever it may be by maybe killing somebody, because, I don't know, he's a psychopath.
Well, I think you hit the nail on the head on that one, Johnny. The letter is going to be followed up by a second one that was sent to the White House.
Short episode. That's it for this week.
The letter was sent to one was also sent to the White House, where it gets intercepted on April 17th. And there's actually a first letter that was sent to a judge, Judge Sadie Holland, who's a county judge. on the 10th, but from like where? She's a county judge out in Mississippi, and like their office like saw the letter and like, ah, whatever, and didn't think anything of it. And just like, and didn't know it fucking contained ricin until like the news broke about these other two letters I hit. They're like, oh shit, I got one too.
Oh shit, that's kind of, yeah, that's kind of similar.
The same exact letter that I got. Yeah. I didn't know. I licked the powder and it tasted a little bitter, but nothing happened.
What is that? That's weird. Salt? I don't know. What is that?
Anyways, the FBI sends these letters for testing. Allegedly, they all test positive for ricin. It takes the FBI like 0 seconds to hone in on their first suspect. In fact, they detain him on the very day that the letter reaches the White House. So, way to go, taxpayer dollars.
Holy cow.
Same fucking day.
I mean, that's efficient work right there. That's how you do it. That's the fastest government work has ever operated.
I'm going to put a picture of this guy up here because I'm going to describe him, and the best way to describe him is with a picture. Their suspect of choice, okay. Johnny, is an ex-school janitor, Elvis impersonator from Corinth, Mississippi, named Kevin Curtis.
Okay.
He also operates a little bit of a...
Two first names
always the best people to have two first names. and he operates a conspiracy theory Facebook page. Their evidence that they... Yeah, they're
does
evidence.
He now?
This
That's
is all
weird.
The evidence they have against him. His name is Kevin
That's
Curtis,
all you
so
need.
Initials a match.
I rest my case. Guilty.
Initials a match. He runs a conspiracy theory Facebook page where every one of his posts ends with "I am KC and I approve this message." So that's not a great that's...
That's clue. That's the second clue that they had. What do we have to go on, boys? I don't know. They're just a signature that he uses every time he does any of his conspiracy bullshit.
He's written a book, Johnny, that he's trying to get published, going all over the place trying to get published.
Has
The book's title is...
Oh, well, I mean, he should just go on, like, Amazon or whatever. You can just have it published now.
Yeah.
Like,
well, yeah, this was a little before Amazon was doing that. Yeah, they weren't doing the self-publishing back in 2013.
Yeah, if they started earlier, this wouldn't have happened, and we could have avoided this tragedy. Maybe. Well, I guess nothing happened, so...
The book's title, Johnny, is Missing Pieces, which is directly taken out of the Missing Pieces, so there's that.
Of course.
His book is about...
Let me fill you in on those missing pieces. I assume he fills you in.
Yeah, the missing pieces are body parts that he believes the government has a conspiracy by selling harvested body parts to people? We'll get into why thing... Yeah,
where are
we'll
they
get
harvest-
into that.
Okay, they're harvesting them from... Just
people? Yeah.
Anybody?
Well,
and so they're kidnapping.
Give me a minute. I promise we'll come full circle.
And then selling them.
Selling them, I guess. Yeah. We'll come full circle to that, Johnny. I promise you. Just bear with me. The other little bit of evidence they have against him is that he does have pictures of himself with Roger Wicker. He did have a run-in with Judge Holland. Actually, she sentenced him to a brief stint in jail for assaulting one of his cover band members. So, you know. Apparently,
He's in a cover band.
He's
an
Elvis impersonator, Johnny. Of course, he's got a cover band. Yeah.
Oh, okay. Just Elvis. That's okay. I kind of didn't think that they would have a band to go along. I thought it'd be a solo thing there.
No,
he's legit Elvis person.
He's the legit Elvis person. Yep. The FBI are going to pick up Kevin when he is in his car with his pet Chihuahua mix named Moo Cow. He's going to get his mail. They swarm him. They rip him out of the car. They detain him and they start questioning him for hours, where they do the typical FBI thing, where they lead you down a path where they're trying to get you to confess to something using less than ethical and less than legal ways of doing that, where they're like basically like,
I don't think that's the case, Tommy. I think they conduct their practices to the letter of the law, and they found that this man was probably guilty, and he admitted it.
Well, he's clueless as to what he's done wrong, because in his mind, he's not done anything illegal, and besides...
He's done nothing wrong. He is just trying to fill some people in.
Elvis...
Some missing pieces. promote his book, maybe. I don't know.
Besides being a bad Elvis impersonator, it's like, what have I... The FBI have no business to arrest me.
You don't know he's bad.
Well, fair enough.
That's editorializing, Tommy. That's not very.
That was my opinion.
He might be, but in any case, a mediocre Elvis impersonator.
He might be.
For all you
very
know.
Could be. I've not seen him. So you're right. I'm just assuming. My experience with Elvis impersonators is they're never that.
Oh, they're all bad.
But
yeah.
All in any bad. Case, because they finally like just
starting point was, it doesn't matter.
Yeah, the FBI finally just loses their shit, and they're like, listen, you've hurt a lot of people with what you've done, which, by the way, he hasn't. Nobody actually got hurt by these letters, but you've hurt a lot of people what you've done. He's like, what have I done?
He's like, yeah, I did it.
And he goes, you know what you did, the letters that you sent with ricin in them. And he goes, I don't even like rice. You can search my house. I've never even eaten rice a day in my life. What are you talking about? And at this point, the FBI is like, oh.
Hold up.
This guy's pretty dumb. Maybe we fucked up.
He might. Oh, no.
But they got enough evidence. They got at least enough probable cause to go and search his house. And when they search his house, they find Dinkus. They find the missing pieces conspiracy manuscript that he's written. But they find no evidence to suggest that he even knows what ricin is, let alone knows how to manufacture it.
Wait.
They search all of his computers. Like, there's no, like, Google search history. How do you create ricin?
How do I do ricin?
Nothing.
Did somebody frame
like,
him?
Do you have any enemies? And he goes, oh, well, let me tell you about my enemies. He's a conspiracy theorist. Of course he's got enemies.
Yeah. No shit. So Jim down the street here, I called him out on his whatever. Hey, all right. so he has enemies.
So he's got enemies. So so at this point, I have to introduce you to James Everett Dushky, or Dutchky Dushky. I'm going to call him Dushky because this guy's kind of a douche. He is from Tupelo, Mississippi. He's a resident who owns and operates a karate/taekwondo dojo, and he's a front man of a blues band and proud member of Mensa. And if you're not aware what Mensa is, that's the made-up club that
they're Renaissance
super
man.
Intelligent.
Holy
they have to have
shit.
Above like 110 IQ or some shit like that, and you can get a little Mensa subscription thing or whatever. It's a
You get into a book.
It's a scam.
Yeah,
don't do that.
Yeah.
It's a scam.
You can order a copy of the book for just $999.
Yeah. It's just don't do
or
it.
Or three easy payments of
$300. But he's a proud Mensa member, so I have to explain the feud to you. In 1999, Curtis is working at a hospital as a janitor. Late at night, he gets a little thirsty. He decides, I'm going to go down and get a beverage. He sees a refrigerator. He opens up said refrigerator, and inside said refrigerator is a bunch of body parts. And he goes, oh, my God, it's a conspiracy. The government's harvesting our body parts and selling them.
Wait,
which
what?
Would be concerning, except you're in the hospital morgue. Of course there's body parts. He's in the hospital morgue. Like, did you not read the sign above the door that you came into where you found a refrigerator?
That,
he's just wandering around the hospital, cleaning up, sees a refrigerator going, I wonder if somebody's got a soda in here. Opens it up, and there's body parts. You're in the morgue, dude. Like,
and it's, it's organ donor body parts, likely, right? I would imagine.
I'd imagine, probably. He runs off with this idea. He creates his conspiracy theory. He writes books, manuscripts, tries to get them published. Nobody is publishing. Nobody's biting. He winds up...
That's shocking. I cannot believe that.
Right. He winds up meeting Everett Dushky because Everett is actually working with his brother at the time at an insurance company. And Everett is publishing a mostly debunked truth newspaper. I didn't start it with that. Mostly debunked truth newspaper. So basically, conspiracy theorist bullshit, all that crap. And he's proud. Like on his newspaper, he goes, "I will publish anything." Probably should.
That's right. Truth. Publish anything though. Not gonna do any sort of fact checking. Not gonna check any of it out. We're just gonna. You got a wacky idea? got you covered.
I'll publish it. But in any case, so Curtis is like, hell yeah. He goes to Dushky, gives him the manuscript and says, you should really publish this. To which point, Dushky just flat out ignores him and says, nah, I'm not going to publish that.
Not even the guy who will publish everything will publish
it. It's
this.
Now 2006, Johnny. Everett is now working with Curtis's ex-wife. Curtis finds out that Everest is working with his ex-wife and winds up just crashing a work function and yells at Everett in front of everybody, calling him a liar for not publishing his conspiracy theory. Everett Dushky's like, listen, I can't publish this, it's beyond ridiculous, and I'm going to be running. I'm going to be running for the House of Representatives, so I can't publish this because I'm running for office.
Yes, of course.
Who you ask is he running for office against? But Judge Holland's son, Steve Holland. So,
how about that?
Full circle a little bit. And basically his entire campaign is just one gigantic smear campaign where the dude hates the other dude and like there's nothing else to his office. I hate that guy. I'm gonna run against him. And
this guy's an asshole.
The campaign is such an embarrassment and a joke where he's pretty much ousted from politics ever again. Like, no, like that
this isn't for you, pal. This you gave it your all. Gave it your best, but it turns out your best is not nearly good enough.
Which is a sad thing to say, considering who we've had running lately for said offices. But in any case.
Well, we had higher standards back in the day, Tommy.
Slightly. Curtis, then, on his like Facebook, if I said slightly back then. Yeah, it's not that far back then, though. So
it was, slightly.
It's still, I guess, 06. I mean, that's Obama era, so I guess it's slightly better. But in any case, we've got Curtis.
People were trying. Yeah.
Curtis gets on Facebook, starts making fun of Everett on his Facebook page, where Everett's, because Everett started the band, he started his blues techno-funk band that he had, Curtis is just making fun of that on Facebook, and making fun of him for losing his political campaign on Facebook.
Making fun of the Taekwondo instructor's blues band. On Facebook.
Sounds so much worse when you slow
down. I can see how this led to poisoning. A janitor Taekwondo instructor battle of the ages. Like, good God.
In 2010, Johnny, Curtis begins goading Everett on Facebook, saying that Curtis himself has received membership into the Mensa and posts a fake certificate of his Mensa membership or whatever.
What he actually did was he took an intro to Photoshop course and got the free software. That's how I'm going to do this. Look at that. Now it's my name on this Mensa certificate.
It sure is. Everett Newski, he gets onto Facebook and threatens to sue Curtis because that's a lie. That document's a lie. You can't forge a legal document like that. And everybody knows that a Mensa certificate is legally binding.
Right. And you are now going to go to jail for making a Photoshop of this document because the law takes Mensa so seriously.
Fast forward just a little bit more time. We're now in like late 2011, early 2012. And Everett has gotten himself arrested. Everett Dushki has gotten himself arrested for fondling three underage girls, the youngest being seven, at his dojo.
God damn it.
So
this was just a fun story for a bit, and now pedophile. That's great.
And of course,
so
Curtis
not
does...
only a Taekwondo instructor, blues frontman, also a pedophile.
Pedophile. I got to put that pedophile in there. Yep. You got to do that.
Fantastic.
So Curtis goes ahead and gets on Facebook and makes fun of him even more for getting arrested for being a pedophile, which, as he should.
On account of, being a fucking pedophile. Yeah. No, I'm on your side there, bud. Yeah, you go ahead and right? poke fun at because what's he going to do? He's going to be in jail, I would assume. I would hope.
Yep.
Right? One would assume.
He was arrested and released until the trial, so no, not in jail. But he is forced to close the dojo.
Yeah, because...
can't be around children.
Does he have to?
You're suspected of...
He can't have his little...
No, can't have his dojo.
He can't have his little rape building anymore.
Nope, no more rape building. Now, the FBI takes all this information that I have just told to you, and they go ahead and release Curtis of all suspicions on the 23rd of April, and they take that accusation of Curtis against Everett, that Everett had framed him, and pretty much only that's their only evidence that they have at this point is that, like, the story that Curtis has just told about Everett. And then they go and they start looking at Everett Dushki, where they search his house and find... a fuck ton of evidence that he's making Ricin? Like, this is...
Ah! Shut up.
Oh, no, no, he initially denies guilt, plays dumb. He's like, I don't even know who Curtis is. We met like once on like this work function or something. And like, I don't even know who he is. Why would I frame this guy? Of course, like... he also denied ever fondling the girls too. But so, you know, that. But, you know, when you find Ricin in the house.
So he's a bit of a liar and maybe a scumbag.
And you find out that, you know, he lost an election to the judge's child. He had, in fact, also met the senator. Yeah. And if you're going to send a letter...
What are the three things, Tommy?
Means, opportunity, motive.
That they look
means
for?
Means, opportunity, motive, yeah.
Yeah, those are the three. Motive, means, and opportunity. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. And it sounds like he may have had all
and
three of
those. And he literally just looked at the Facebook page of Curtis and was like, I'll just use his sign-off name and the name of his book, and it'll throw people off the trails. Which, to be fair...
Which, I mean, that's a heady play. That was good. He had
the only thing
well
he was missing was to like sprinkle some
Curtis
Ricin.
Was so fucking dumb.
Yeah. All,
that
yeah.
He's like, I don't even like rice. Why would I do? He didn't anticipate how dumb this
dumb Curtis
would be.
Was. Yeah. Yeah. Pretty like, much. Pretty much. Well, he is going to plead when he goes to court. He is going to plead guilty to the charges in regards to the Ricin. He does not plead guilty to the pedophilia charges. He does get sentenced to 25 years in jail in 2014.
Oh,
so he does get 25
enough.
Years in jail. But the story here, Johnny, it's not quite done yet because we still have those fondling charges, which he is going to court for. He is found guilty of. He is sentenced to 20
yes.
years, but the sentence is suspended because of his 25-year federal sentence for the Ricin letters. But the judge, Johnny, the judge slaps him on the wrist and says, listen, if you ever contact those girls again, I will make you serve those 20 years additionally to the 25 you served for a completely unrelated crime. Where the fuck is the justice? Apparently, you can be a pedophile in America and it's okay because, like, this proves it.
Did he ask? Is he like, well, what if it's like 11 years from now? And they're like,
they're adults.
Is that okay?
No, it's a lifetime. It's a lifetime ban. You can never contact those kids
lifetime.
Again.
Oh, forever. I can never. Oh, never.
Mm-mm.
Oh, okay. Well, as long as you tell him he can't fondle children, I guess that's enough. Maybe somebody should have started that earlier. Maybe
Johnny,
we
you're
going to
get
people, just as.
Gonna,
all right, hey, all right, get... blanket statement here. Folks, don't touch children.
Yeah, don't do that. You're also going to get
blanket
mad here because the
statement.
25-year sentence for attempting to kill the President of the United States, which, again, doesn't seem long enough, that's actually only 10 years
it
day for day. So he has to serve 10 years day for day, so jail now. He's in jail. But after that 10 years day for day, it's like good service time gets knocked off. So, you know... That 25 years can very easily become, like, 15.
How?
Right? Yeah.
I mean, I guess, what's he going to do? Try to, like, assassinate a different president?
Try to rape more children, Johnny. That's what he can do.
Well, that I'm worried about, but it's like the
president's thing.
We're
yeah,
past
yeah,
that
yeah,
because
whatever,
obviously
whatever.
He got off of that scot-free.
Yeah.
Nobody much. Cares about that. But, like, with a, like, I guess, after, you know, after time... What's gonna happen? What's he gonna do? Yeah.
Now, if you're before I sign off here on this episode, if
Obama's
you're wondering
gone.
About if you're wondering about Curtis, he is actually on disability for bipolar. Shocking.
Is it? Is he now?
Still gets some. He gets some. He tours with his Elvis impersonation. So I guess if you're wanting to see an Elvis impersonator, you can find
him. I cannot believe that an Elvis impersonator would be unemployed on disability. That is
and he
very
is
off
still
brand.
Trying to find a publisher for his book, which has not.
So
yet,
if you're a publisher,
been, published,
and you wanna, and you're looking for the next big hit. Why don't you go ahead and contact this disabled Elvis impersonator who is kind of a piece of shit, but not a attempted assassinator.
Nope, he's definitely not. So,
it's good. That's it for this week in Historic Hindsight. Thanks for listening. Be sure to subscribe, rate, and review, and join us next week when we talk about the shit that John Quincy Adams did. Adams. That guy.